Our crops are eating junk food, and so are we, because what we put in the soil ends up back on our plates.
This video is a journey from the rice fields of Thailand to the forest floor, where nature's nutrient cycle still works, and what we can learn from it before it's too late. For over 5,000 years, these fields produced rice through a natural cycle, organic matter in, nutrients out. Generations worked with the soil, not against it. Then came the Green Revolution. In the 1960s, new high-yield crops promised to feed the world, but they had a hidden cost. These crops were engineered to grow faster, and they came with an appetite. To survive, they needed something new, chemical fertilizer. It started with a simple diet, small amounts of NPK, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. But over time, that wasn't enough.
Chop you now, mate.
Chop, chop, chop. อยู่ทุ่งนาเมื่อประมาณ 40 ปีให้หลังไปก็ใช้พลังงานตัวเองปากดำทุกต้นถอนก้าหวานก้าแล้วก็ถอนก้าแล้วก็เป็นปากฉ่ำปากดำทุกวันนี้เขาใช้หวานกันหมดมันก็จะไม่ลำบากเท่าไหร่ปุ๋ยหมักคือปุ๋ยอินทรีย์ปุ๋ยชีวภาพที่ใช้จากสารจากมูลสัตว์มูลวัวมูลควายที่ใช้เมื่อก่อน มาพักหลังๆก็ใช้จะใช้ปุ๋ยเคมีเสริมมันมีปุ๋ยเคมีเข้ามาเสริมก็จะมีปุ๋ยเคมีที่มีสูตร NPK N นี่ก็คือไนโตรเจนทั้งหมด P ก็คือ Phosphorus ที่เป็นประโยชน์แล้วก็ K ก็คือ Potassium ก็ใช้มาแล้วประมาณ 30-40 ปีนี่แหละประมาณนี้เมื่อก่อนไม่ใช้เลยเมื่อก่อนมันก็ใช้เฉพาะมูลสัตว์ครั้งแรกที่ใช้ปุ๋ยเคมี
นี่มีหลายอย่างมีแมกนีเซียมโซเดียมบอรอนนี่ครั้งแรกใส่ปุ๋ยเคมีต้องใส่ทุกอย่างแบบนี้ไหมไม่เมื่อก่อนไม่ได้ใส่ทุกอย่างใส่เฉพาะ NPK เท่านั้น
So it started simple, just NPK, three minerals to force rapid growth, a chemical candy bar for crops. But the dosage kept going up. In Thailand, fertilizer use skyrocketed from just 1.7 kilograms per hectare in 1961 to 167 kilograms by 2004. That's nearly 100 times more. And the diet kept getting more complicated. As the soil's natural pantry is being stripped bare, farmers are being told to add even more. Magnesium, zinc, boron, minerals that once came freely from healthy, living soil. The more we feed, the more it starves. We're trapped in a cycle of diminishing returns, dumping more and more just to grow the same. The most worrying part for us is what this means for the food on our plates. It's not just the soil that's changing, it's the food itself. Studies show that many fruits and vegetables today have lower levels of key nutrients than they did 50 years ago. That's partly because modern crops are bred for yield, size, and shelf life, not nutrition, but soil health plays a role too. Healthy soil helps unlock and deliver micronutrients. When we disrupt that cycle, when we replace biology with a chemical drip, we weaken the connection between plant and planet. The result? More food, less nourishment. We're in a downward spiral and we face a choice. Keep propping up dying soil with chemical life support, or rebuild a living system, one that can feed itself and us. Back in the UK, if I bumped into someone with their face fully covered and a big knife in their hand, I probably wouldn't assume they were out looking for mushrooms. But life in Thailand is different.
So these woods here are a few kilometres away from our farm, and they're really popular with the locals, particularly old ladies that come here with their basket and look for mushrooms. It's not a national park or anything, so people are allowed to come. So let's have a look and see if we can find anything.
We're told by industrial agriculture that soil must be constantly fed to produce anything worthwhile. On big farms, growing crops like rice or corn, it's normal to dump over 200 kilograms of nitrogen fertilizer per hectare every single year. But here's where it gets weird. When scientists test the soil in mature forests like these, they find shockingly low levels of nitrogen in a form ready for plants to absorb, certainly much lower than what industrial farming insists is necessary. According to that model, this forest should be starving. These trees should be stunted, yellow, and dying. But they're not. they're thriving. So what's going on? Just because nitrogen isn't sitting there in a ready-to-eat form doesn't mean it's not in the system. We're just looking in the wrong place.
Imagine you wanted to research how much food there was available in the kitchen of a busy restaurant to be sent out to hundreds of customers at a time. Now, the area of a kitchen where the food gets passed from the back of house to the front of house is called the pass. This is once a meal is ready, the chefs will leave it there. Now, imagine your study only focused on that area. You'd only ever see two or three plates there at any time, and most of the time there'd be nothing there. Well, that's mad. You're not looking at all of the food that's in storage, and you're not looking at the chefs that are preparing everything. Well, the forest has its own kitchen staff that the agricultural industry ignores.
The problem isn't the forest, it's how we measure it. Industrial agriculture looks at soil like only checking what's sitting on the shelf at any given moment, ignoring the busy kitchen behind it. But a forest runs on a live kitchen. No chemicals, no brute force, just biology. And the secret to this living kitchen, we're about to find it.
What is it?
It's kai.
An army of microscopic chefs working around the clock, breaking down organic matter and delivering nutrients on demand. And here's the crazy part. Studies show that a healthy forest cycles as much nitrogen, if not more, than an industrial farm, but does it sustainably, for free, all year round. And almost none of that nitrogen is washed away into the rivers and lakes, so the surrounding environment remains unpolluted. This here is what it's all about. But the mushroom you see is just the fruit. The real magic is underground, a vast fungal network of mycelium. These fungi are the superhighways of the soil. They form symbiotic partnerships with 95% of plants, trading sugars from the roots for nutrients the fungi can mine from the deep. Magnesium, zinc, phosphorus, everything and anything the plant needs, delivered in balance. This is nature's most efficient delivery system. So if it works this well in the forest, could it work back on my own degraded farm soil? Okay, before I go full on nerd mode back at the farm, let's take a quick breather. It's time to catch up with some of the local aunties and get their expert opinion on our mushroom haul.
Any suai mai? My yurt.
And grab a big bowl of noodle soup for the bargain price of 40 baht. Just over a year ago, we tried something that, at the time, felt a bit mad. We ran an experiment right here on the farm.
These trees you see behind me are called yang na. They're a hardwood that are native across Asia, but in Thailand, they're famous for something else, the mushrooms that grow at their feet. These particular trees have been in the ground about 4 years and they're growing pretty well, but we planted quite a lot. Some of them died, some of them aren't doing so well. So we wanted to try a different approach. Here, look, this one over here has been in the ground for over 2 years and it's starting to do okay, but it's really taking its time. Other ones have just died. There's a lot of information online and on YouTube in Thai about how to make your own fungal culture. They tell you which species of mushrooms have a symbiotic relationship with these trees and how to harvest those mushrooms and create your own culture. So we tried. We put it in a bucket with some fungal foods, and after a week or so, we started to see this fungal network growing on the surface of the bucket. So we applied that solution to some of the saplings, and then something amazing happened. After about another week, some white spots started showing up on the surface of the soil where the saplings were growing, the first sign of fungal activity. So in this area here, where we keep some guinea fowl and some ducks, we planted a lot of these yang na trees. And you can see some of them are growing very well. They've only been in the ground for just over a year. And I mean, look at the size of that one. A year. That's unbelievable.
As I near the end of the Soil Food Web Foundation course, I finally have the tools to see why up close. I've had this microscope for months, but I've been a bit scared of it. Turns out, getting one tiny drop of water to spread evenly on a slide is harder than it sounds. And I don't remember seeing these tidal waves in the training videos. Although, I've got to admit, it looks pretty cool. But once things settled down, boom, right there in one drop, fungal hyphae. Different colours, shapes, sizes, multiple species, all living right by the roots of a tree we planted by ourselves. Honestly, that did feel pretty special. Now, not all fungi are good, so how can you tell if you've found the good guys? Dr. Elaine Ingham from the Soil Food Web gives us a helpful checklist. First, colour is good. Brown, red, black, even golden. Second, the width should be even all the way along. If it's lumpy or swollen, that's a red flag. Third, look for evenly spaced crosswalls called septa. If they're consistently spaced, we're on the right track. Fourth, where it breaks, a clean 90 degree snap is better than a messy tear. So this sample, tick, 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 tick. So now, in full-on nerd mode, I got a bit excited. I started hunting all over the farm, under a pile of old branches, fungi, from soil where we didn't add inoculum, fungi, and then the jackpot, taking a small bit of soil from our basket of mushrooms we picked this morning. Even at low magnification, there were hyphae everywhere. And when I zoomed in, it was beautiful. Honestly, I might hang this on my wall. Does anyone else want a print? But let's go back for a second to where that first microscope sample came from. Right at the base of our Yang Na trees, I found something even more surprising. This isn't soil, it's clay, like real clay. Patrick Swayze could make a vase out of this, and yet in this dense, heavy material, I still found beneficial fungi. That's wild, because I've also learned how important oxygen is. Good soil needs structure, air pockets for oxygen and water to move through, creating the perfect home for beneficial microbes. Heavily compacted clay is supposed to be a more hostile environment, but the microscope says otherwise, and the trees are growing much faster than our previous attempts. So, what gives? As a wise man, Jeff Goldblum, once said, "Nature finds a way." Maybe it wasn't just our fungal culture, maybe something more was going on, because nature doesn't work alone, it works in teams. Take a look at these huge structures, termite mounds. They're popping up all over the place. And underground, a vast network of tunnels providing natural aeration, pathways for water, oxygen, and life. And termites don't work alone either. They partner with a fungus called termite mushrooms. The termites farm this fungus inside their mounds, and in return, it helps break down tough wood, making it easier for them to digest. They're roommates, and many varieties of termite mushrooms are also edible, which is awesome. Now look over here. This little plant, gradually replacing the weedy grass, is a pinto peanut. It's a type of legume, which organic farmers know as nitrogen-fixing plants. They take nitrogen directly from the atmosphere and put it back in the ground. But even they rely on teamwork. It's not the plant doing the chemistry, it's bacteria. Tiny, nitrogen-fixing microbes bond with the plant roots and use enzymes to split atmospheric nitrogen and convert it into ammonia, actual plant food. Everywhere you look, there's an army of underground chemists and couriers at work. Together, they form a massive living delivery system, bringing plants not just calories, but a complete and balanced diet. The full mineral spectrum we're losing from our agricultural fields, they can provide it all. Millions of years of evolution has created a mind-blowingly complex system that runs 24/7 and it works for free, if only we let it.
These mushrooms aren't just tasty, they're full of potassium, zinc, iron, phosphorus, everything that's missing from our soils and from our food. Cheers!
Their fruiting bodies feed us and their underground network feed the plants. The food isn't just empty calories, this is real food, grown by a system that worked for millions of years, without chemicals and without shortcuts. Both us and our crops are hooked on junk food, and it's time we started to wean off. But I didn't get here overnight. If you saw my last video, you'll know our original permaculture plan looked beautiful, but it wasn't paying the bills. We've had a few wins, but honestly, quite a few expensive mistakes. If you want the full story of how we got here, it's all in that video. Click here and I'll see you there.